And why is that? Now, that we have to think about. We all know, we in IANAS all know that global economic development requires a science and technology foundation in both the developed and the developing countries. That is where it begins. And now it is so that the population in the developing countries consists for maybe 50% either rural women or women migrating to the mega cities. The rural women are responsible for the farming, for providing water, fuel, nutrition, and health care to their families and communities. The women migrating to the mega cities will need access to clean water, food, sanitation, electricity, and access to healthcare. And access to healthcare, information, and education for their families. For global capacity building, we need empowerment of the women at the grassroots. Where the grassroots means the rural women and the women migrating to the mega system, mostly uneducated, but absolutely essential to the survival of their communities and their families, and doing the brunt of the work at that level, because the men often go away to work somewhere else. In some communities, men don't do any work, and the women are the main providers and workers. So, the women experts would be the most effective at transferring technology to the women at the grassroots. How do we get there is two ways of thinking about the economic development. One is, well, we need water in that village. So we get this engineer, maybe from a foreign country, and he looks at the mountain, he says, that's where the water comes from. Or he says, well, we are going to drill. And the equipment comes in, the well is drilled, or the water is led through pipes from the mountain. The villagers don't have an inkling what is going on. And one day, all of a sudden, they learn that there is a water spout and the water comes out. Great. So, engineer packs up and leaves, goes back to the comfort of his home, and all of a sudden, there is no water coming out of the spout, for one reason or another. What do we do? There are no local experts. The people who have the interest, who are served by it, have not been involved. So, the right way to go about this is to make sure that the women users are part of the game, are partners in the project, are made to understand how this works and are trained to take care of it. So we have to transfer the technology to these women. And have the foreign engineers been trained to do that? If you look I looked at the IAC report on agriculture in Africa. That was one of the previous reports. 70% of the African farmers are women. They are not mentioned in the report except one sentence. The African farmers are mostly women and they are illiterate. And that's it. How can you transfer technology if you don't even talk about the people who actually have the knowledge, the local knowledge and experience? So how do you get to that level? I think there are undoubtedly men who can be sensitized and trained to do that and include that as an important part of the whole project. But much more naturally is use the women experts, women civil engineers, women trained in the mechanical engineering or whatever you need for these particular fields. and ask them to work with the local population in a cooperative mode. So that is the picture that this book paints, and that is the philosophy of my co-chair that's practiced in India. And so we need both the women experts and we need the empowerment of the women at the grassroots. Okay? So this is the image. All the way on the left, you see two women that are obviously not the tribal women that you see on the right. We are in Thailand. We are in the mountains. There is a small tribe. And the two women on the left are civil engineering students from the University of Maryland in the USA. Their thesis professor is a woman professor in civil engineering. Every summer, she takes her students, female and male, to Thailand to work on a project in development project. So there they are. What are they doing? They're building a wastewater system for a health clinic that they are helping to build. And how are they doing it? It's a joint team. They work side by side. And the professor already told me that the women villagers are much better diggers than her students. But they work cooperatively, side by side. That is the, so this is a model. You transfer it to the, and adapt it to the various circumstances. So that's what I'm advocating. Okay, obstacles. Here go the obstacles. You have heard them all. The traditional myths that have persisted until in the US, until maybe 15 years ago. And 15 years ago, it was not still so that in high school, the girls learned. You cannot do math. You don't care about science. You better do something sweet, like become a teacher or a nurse. Technology is for boys. Those are the traditional myths. Now the facts. Girls all through the 20th century were discouraged from taking physics and advanced mathematics classes in high schools. Consequence, there are no women in physics. Is that surprising? If you come out of high school with no advanced math or physics, forget about a career in physics. Forget about a career in engineering. Your fate is already sealed. You will never make up. Okay, the performance of boys was different from that of girls in math and science. In math, there were simply no top girls. There were just boys, say 13 to 1 or so. Then all of a sudden, it started to dawn that this had to change. And maybe beginning in the 1990s, they stopped the practice of discouraging girls to get into the advanced classes and to tell them the traditional myth, you are better as a nurse. Yeah? So, and now in the good high schools, in the area where I live, the Washington area, a highly educated area, there are just about as many girls as boys that take those classes. And maybe that's a surprise, that was not known. The girls do as well as the boys, if not better. Still in math, the boys have an advantage. And maybe that is genetic. Science will reveal that at some point. But for the time being, there's enormous egalization of the sexes in those fields in the high schools, and they stream on to college. So in the undergraduate school, the girls are now 20-30% of the hard science and math classes. So it's a major change. Now this is the conclusion. and